music of George M. Cohan.
Nephew of Uncle Sam? Certainly. Cohan was an offspring of a country booming with pride, flexing its national muscles, becoming aware of its new strength. But born on the 4th of July, he was not. George M., for Michael Cohan, insisted for many years that he shared his birthday with his country, and in fact many biographies carried that date. However, his birth certificate implacably places the event one day earlier, on the 3rd of July, in 1878 at Providence, Rhode Island. Born the last of three children to vaudevillian parents, Jeremiah and Helen, who toured the circuit. And from that moment, his life story reads like a theatrical textbook. As a child, George received a smattering of schooling in the elementary grade, also a few violin lessons. He hated both and soon abandoned them. His remaining education came from inside the theatre. As an infant, George Cohan made his stage debut as a human prop in one of his father's acts. At 8, he played the violin in the pit orchestra. At 9, he made his first entrance in a Cohan sketch. A year later, his elder sister Josephine joined the act, and by 1888, they were officially baptized the Four Cohans. By the time he was 11, George was beginning to contribute material for the Four Cohans, and by 15, he shared a solo spot with his sister. The next year, George, all the time gathering expertise in the theatre, turned his hand to songwriting. His first effort, Why Did Nellie Leave Home, he sold outright for $25. But the publishing house got somebody to revise his lyrics, an early blow to the burgeoning Cohan ego, and the last time George ever allowed anyone to tamper with one of his songs. By now, George was a man on the move. He was becoming a familiar figure around New York, where he hounded publishers with his songs and wore down their resistance through the sheer power of his confidence and his persuasion. Brash, self-assured, and cocky, a self-opinionated youngster with an implicit faith in his gifts, they said of him.
What you need is something new, Mr. Albee, and that something new happens to be spelled C-O-H-A-N. Go on, Mom. Hot. You're on.
That's good old musical moon. That's the thing about it every tune. Never wearing out painted on the scenery of a musical play. Honeymoon, honeymoon, even got a sunny moon. Musical moon. That rhymes with June and spoon and prune. Go the leading lady gets the dough.
Wherefore art thou Romeo?
Folks will tell you that there ain't no show till they bring on that musical moon.
Great, kids, great. And now I want you to meet the pride and joy of the family, the most talented little miss in vaudeville, Miss Josie Cohan.
Oh, you wonderful boy, what a wonderful boy you are. You've made the world appear to me, near to me, dear to me.
Josie, that was beautiful. And now, kid, I want you to get a load of a song, a step, and a personality that I guarantee you will take New York by storm a week after we open. Little Georgie himself. Goodbye, my lady love. So long, my turtle dove. Farewell, my honeysuckle, I gotta go. While I am on my way, I'll phone you every day. I'll tell you how I am if you wanna know.
I'll hear if you're acting gaily.
Don't be leery.
Will I get my letter daily?
Yes, my dearie.
Honey, goodbye.
Dearie, don't cry. Honey, dear, you know I've gotta go. Time to say goodbye, that's all. So long, can't you hear the train man calling? All aboard for Broadway. I'll be back again. Hurry, dear, now just one kiss. Just thank you for the fun. I'll miss it by Miss the Broadway train.
Thank you.
With songwriting, George Cohan had so far had little luck. But his first major publishing success came with the first popular song about wireless telegraphy, I Guess I'll Have to Telegraph My Baby. Ethel Levy introduced it to vaudeville. She was also introduced to George Cohan. And in July 1899, in Atlantic City, New Jersey, she became his wife, at the same time joining the Four Cohans. As the family team began to achieve greater success before the footlights, George, with what seemed like limitless energy, took an increasing control of every department of their act. He wrote the songs and sketches, managed the business affairs, and took the starring role. The Four Cohans were by now earning the considerable sum of $1,000 a week, in days when a dollar really was worth a dollar. It was about this time that Cohan started a lifelong habit of making a brief final curtain speech to his audience.
My mother thanks you. My father thanks you. My sister thanks you. And I thank you.
By now, George was beginning to feel restless and uneasy. He'd gone as far as he could in vaudeville, but he knew there was a new world to conquer, a new outlet for his varied talents, and he had that target in sight, the Broadway musical comedy stage. There was a new century at hand, and with it, a new age for America and Americans. Cohan was to be its symbol and its spokesman.
No time to pitch woo now, the century's new now. I'm singing my love songs in that new ragtime. The minute I meet ya, I send for the preacher and order those wedding bells to chime. I'm a Yankee with know-how, don't wanna go slow now. Can't wait for that moon above, or even a dove. So kiss me and run, kid. It's 1901, kid, and be my 20th century love.
You'll have
to it's something a day now. For ready-made wedding gown we demonstrate. Don't look when you're hooked, kid. Your goose has been cooked, kid. There's ready no timing, don't be late.
Wait, go! I need that old moon of mine. She's taken my gloves. My parasol's missing. My hand someone's kissing. Take back your 20th century life.
What's the
1901, 1902, 1903. In the opening years of the new century, George began his first musical comedy experiments, expanding vaudeville sketches with a few songs. The Governor's Son came to Broadway in 1901, starring the Five Cohans, with George M. directing. Broadway rejected it. But on the road over the next 2 years or so, it did much better, and returning to New York, the Governor's Son doubled its original run. His second attempt, running for office, was much the same story. In 1904, Cohan formed a partnership with Sam Harris, a relationship, personal and professional, which was to last for many years and for which Cohan would write his greatest stage successes. The first venture of the new production team of Cohan and Harris was the vehicle that launched George upon the musical stage. It opened in New York at the Liberty Theatre in the autumn. Little Johnny Jones, with George playing the title role, was based on a character inspired by the famous American jockey of the time, Todd Sloan, who'd gone to England to ride in the Derby. Little Johnny Jones, though his first Broadway success, produced two of Cohan's most enduring songs.
I'm the kid that's all the candy. I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy. I'm glad I am. So's Uncle Sam. I'm a real-life Yankee Doodle. Made my name and fame and boodle, just like Mr. Doodle did by riding on a pony. I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy. A Yankee Doodle do or die. A real-life nephew of my Uncle Sam. Born on the 4th of July. I've got a Yankee Doodle sweetheart. She's my Yankee Doodle joy. The Yankee Doodle went to London just to ride the pony. I am that Yankee Doodle boy.
He's my Yankee Doodle dandy. My Yankee Doodle do or die.
Two Yankees part upon a foreign shore, when the good ship's just about to start for old New York once more. With tear-dimmed eye, they say goodbye, they're friends without a doubt. Then the man on the pier shouts,
"Let her clear!"
As the ship strikes out.
The same Broadway production that gave us Yankee Doodle Dandy and Give My Regards to Broadway, Cohan was able to create an effect that gave air to his strong passion for patriotism, a spectacular routine performed on stage with the swirl of American flags, a dazzling display of theatre and nationalistic fervour which was to characterise a Cohan show. All this represented something fresh, new, and and thoroughly American to the musical theater, but it was not to the taste of the critics. They called it crude, noisy, and naive. Mr. Cohan has written a lot of dialogue that has some bright spots, but for the most part is commonplace, to put it kindly. He's provided a dozen and a half musical numbers whose distinguishing feature is ginger. In fact, there is more ginger than music. But, pen it as they might, Cohan's self-assurance and stubbornness would not allow him to admit that Little Johnny Jones was a bad show. Learning from two earlier experiences, he decided to go on the road. And sure enough, it worked. In city after city, Little Johnny Jones filled the houses. All the time, Cohan kept rewriting the show, tightening the action, improving the dialogue. And when he brought the musical back to New York, it put the producing firm of Cohan and Harris on a solid base and made Cohan himself an important box office draw.
You ever see two Yankees part upon a foreign shore? When the good ship is just about to start for old New York once more. With a tear-dimmed eye says goodbye, they're friends without a doubt. And the man on the pier shouts loud and clear as the ship strikes out, give my regards to Broadway, Herald Square. Tell all the boys at 42nd Street that I will soon be there. Whisper of how I'm yearning to mingle with the old-time throng. Give my regards to old Broadway and say that I'll be there ere long.
The Cohan magic of pageant and pizzazz was beginning to take effect. Little Johnny Jones was a hit, but could he repeat his success? If there was ever any apprehension at all about 45 minutes from Broadway, the fair citizens of New Rochelle settled it beyond doubt. New Rochelle was the town, 45 minutes from Broadway, which provided the setting for the story. The Chamber of Commerce felt strongly that the show was a slander on its community, with New Rochelle shown to be a hick town and its inhabitants bumpkins. They even spoke of boycotting the musical, though that never materialized. But the show thrived on the controversy, and the flood of valuable free publicity made it an immense success from the opening night.
Out west I have found, that's where hayseeds abound, and Missouri's a state that designed them. And though this may be, you can take it from me, you don't have to go out west to find them. If you wanna find a real hick delegation, the place where the real Rubens dwell, just hop on a train at the Grand Central Station. Get off when they shout, New Rochelle!
It just came in the mail today. Listen, Miss Templeton. Only 45 minutes to Broadway.
I have no time to listen
up the changes that bring.
You are paid to clean up things.
For the short time it takes. What a difference this makes in the way of...
Rose, will you stop playing that song?
In a minute, honey.
Oh, what a fine bunch of...
This afternoon, gave her her second number. See if you like it.
So long, Mary. Mary, we will miss you so. So long, Mary. How we hate to see you go. And we'll all be longing for you, Mary, while you roam. So long, Mary.
Don't forget to come back home.
Mama!
Another couple of bars, baby. I'm just getting to the good part. It's awfully kind of all you boys to see me off today.
So long, Mary.
I didn't think you'd care if I should either go or stay.
You're wrong, Mary.
Yes, I'm going to Motherland as well. Awfully kind of you to wish me well. Hardly thought of so in your Rochelle. But am I not to say?
So long, Mary. Mary, we will miss you so.
So long, Mary.
How we hate to see you go. And we'll all be longing for you, Mary.
He told me to give you this song and tell you rehearsals begin a week from this Monday.
45 Minutes from Broadway was written by Cohan to display the talents of a burlesque star who wanted to try out the Broadway theater. And the young Faye Templeton made a triumphant debut with songs like Mary's a Grand Old Name. Another of the hit songs from the show was So Long, Mary. In 1906, Cohan thought it about time he wrote another starring role for himself. George Washington Jr. was the vehicle, and in it, Cohan played a super patriot who defies his English father by taking on the name of America's first president. A play with such strong patriotic overtones could be expected to send Cohan into another frenzy of nationalism. And it did.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, forever in display away. You're the emblem of the land I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true under red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. But should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
They'd blow it.
You're a grand old flag allowed Cohan to do one of his beloved flag routines. The idea for the song came from a conversation with a Civil War veteran who'd been a color bearer at Gettysburg. The veteran had remarked proudly, "She's a grand old rag." And when the show George Washington Jr. opened, the song was called "You're a Grand Old Rag." But several patriotic societies complained that to refer to the Stars and Stripes as a rag, well, it was a slur and an insult. Cohan changed rag to flag.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of that I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true under red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. But should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
There's a feeling comes a stealing, and it sets my brain a reeling when I'm listening to the music of a military band.
Any tune like Yankee Doodle simply sets me off my noodle. It's that patriotic something that no one can understand. Red, white, and blue, I am for you. Honest, you're a grand old flag. You're
half dozen years kept Cohan constantly before the Broadway public. The Talk of New York, 50 Miles from Boston, Hello Broadway, The Yankee Prince, Broadway Jones. Musicals remembered now only because of one or two songs. For instance, 50 Miles from Boston, which gave us one of Cohan's most celebrated songs about the Irish.
Hey, G-A-N spells Harrigan. Proud of all the Irish blood that's in me. A gibble a man can say a word against me. H-A-R-R-I-G-A-N, yes, see. It's a name that the shame never has been connected with.
A name that a shame never has been connected with. Harrigan.
Mulligan.
Harrigan.
Mulligan.
Harrigan. Mulligan.
Still under 35, Cohan was now one of the wealthiest and most powerful men in the American theater. The firm of Cohan and Harris had a succession of Broadway hits. In 1 year alone, they had 6 top shows on the stage. They also had a controlling interest in 7 theaters. George worked fast and with great concentration. He was not a man who found it easy to relax. When he was not actually writing or directing, he was thinking, planning, wondering. His one passion was basketball, but he seldom had time to attend a game. There was too much to be done in the theater.
If you wanted to blast it up, why don't you wrap it up, Barnum and Bailey Rag? One by his side is a jumbly, jumbly jag.
Look at the monkey there, look at the donkey there. Just see all those wonderful animals. Do that, do that.
Barnum and Bailey.
Barnum and Bailey.
Barnum and Bailey.
Barnum and Bailey.
Toys can be seen at the barber's wall. Now the game pretty at the barber's wall. Waltz is two steps right by drum. Banjos and those saxophones. There ain't gonna be any street at all. There ain't gonna be any early fall.
If you have ever been in dressing, the blessing is not all the attire, it's the way that you wear the clothes and bear the clothes upon you. It's the way that you wear the clothes, it's all the boys and it is all in the wearing. If a fur is of sable or cat, nobody knows or is caring. It is all in the tint of the hat, though it's shabby and dry. Men are attracted by manner and air. Cost of production they seldom. It's the way you do.
always hated this overrated, pretentious music, complicated in compositions that have conditions and intermissions to please musicians. It's hard to hear it or just be near it. Upon my word, I always fear it, for I'm the original cranky Yankee popular melody fool. Give me a tune that's worth whistling. Give me a tune that's worth listening. I'll choose a strain instead of a box of pain. Give the trombones a chance to blow it. Give me a dash of rag and go. And what I'm stating is advocating the popular melodies of school.
I want to hear a Yankee Doodle tune played by a military band. I want to hear a Yankee Doodle tune, the only music I can understand. Oh, Snoop, come on, you're riding on the march. The yours is just a melody in your eyes. When you play everywhere, you play with all the moment ringers. No, but I will take a Yankee Doodle tune.
April 1917, and for America, war. Super Patriot George M. Cohan was to scale one more peak. Moved by the efforts of the American troops in Europe, he wrote a song that President Woodrow Wilson described at the time as a genuine inspiration to all manhood. It's come to be judged as the greatest American war song.
Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Take it on the run, on the run, on the run. Hear them calling, you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, don't delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. And tell your sweetheart not to pine, to be proud her boy's in line. Over there, over there. Send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums, drums coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Over There, the war classic that was to win for Cohan the Congressional Medal of Honor. By the time the war had ended, 2 million copies of sheet music had been sold, and more than 1 million records. With peace restored to the world, a conflict broke out on Broadway that was to have a profound effect on George, and this time he wasn't fighting on the same side as most of the troops. Actors' Equity called a strike against theatre managers to force them to recognize it as the bargaining representative for its members. They were also concerned about poor conditions, and in some cases, victimization suffered by actors and other theatre employees. Overnight, the lights went out on 12 Broadway shows. In a month, another dozen closed their doors, and Cohan, a theatre owner as well as a performer, took the side of the managers. He argued hotly that the theatre had no place for unionism, and promised to throw every dollar at his command to defeat Equity. George M. Cohan, whose generosity was legendary, who had supported armies of theatrical people during tough times, was shocked at the attitude of his theatre colleagues. He took the strike very much to heart. He felt, in some way, it represented a personal attack, and he became filled with bitterness. By the time the new season had rolled around, Actors' Equity had won the point. The business of Broadway returned to normal, but Cohan would recognize no truce. He saw his only course was to leave the theatre for retirement. A casualty of the bitter feelings he harboured was the highly profitable firm of Cohan and Harris, which he dissolved, ending his long partnership with Sam Harris.
Of course, when Sam and I first went in business together, I naturally thought Sam had a lot of money, you know. Now, we didn't talk about that until we were in the middle of rehearsals of our first show. And when he told me he was broke, that was my first surprise. He seemed to be just as much surprised as I was when I told him I was broke, too. And the members of the company were very much surprised when they found out we were both broke. However, we did all right. We went along for a long time. Eventually, we had a lot of shows, and we got a lot of theaters. And I remember when we started to accumulate our theater interests, I remember I went to my father. I was a little bit worried about coming too involved. I told him what we were doing. I asked him, I said, "Do you think we ought to hang on to these theaters?" And I remember my father's advice. I remember it very well. He said, "Well, I don't know much about whether or not you ought to hang on to the theaters, but you take my tip, kid, and hang on to your dancing shoes."
Retirement didn't come easily, and by 1922, George could not resist the temptation to return to the footlights. And though the Cohan name in musical comedy had begun to lose its magic and the times outdate him, he showed he'd heeded well the advice about those dancing shoes, for on Broadway he remained with few rivals as an actor and dancer. Across the continent, there was a new stage unfolding for the actor, the movies, and Cohan decided to try his hand on the screen. From the very beginning, his Hollywood experience was a disaster. He made his debut for Paramount in The Phantom President, a Rodgers and Hart screen musical starring Jimmy Durante and Claudette Colbert.
Felicia, if ever I propose to you again, and I might, because you're quite the loveliest thing I ever saw, but if ever I propose to you again, you say no.
Why?
Well, because I don't rate a girl like you. I've no right sitting here now. I've no right to come within a mile of you.
No, you're strange. If I didn't know that you weren't a frivolous person, I'd accuse you of playing fast and loose with me.
Fast and loose. That's me.
Let's go home.
For a start, Cohan resented third billing to Jimmy Durante and Claudette Colbert. He also found himself at the mercy of a director, rather than being able to run the show himself, a role that he couldn't easily accept. And to add to his misery, the director tried to teach him how to do a flag routine, Cohan, who had originated and popularized them on stage. Of his Hollywood experience, he was later to say, "If I had my choice between Hollywood and Atlanta, I'll take Leavenworth." He preferred prison rather than working in Hollywood.
Felicia, what I deplore most about the whole thing is that I was compelled to let him associate with you.
You're incredible.
Please believe me, when I consented to this masquerade, I did not think it would involve you. All I thought was that it would help me to realize the crowning ambition of my life, to be president of the United States. And it has.
I congratulate you.
Thank you. And I can assure you that you will not have to endure him any longer.
No?
We'll get rid of him tonight.
What?
Oh, he won't be harmed. Just removed to a safe place in the Arctic Circle.
And it was cold out west for Cohan for quite some time, but eventually he made his peace with Hollywood. In 1942, when Warners decided to pay tribute to the colorful life story of this extraordinary figure of the Broadway theater, vaudevillian, playwright, composer, actor, dancer, Cohan was called in to help with the script and production, and given cast and screenplay approval. The big question was, who would play George? Warner said, "When the time came to choose a star for Yankee Doodle Dandy, one of the finest pictures we ever made, I knew that Cagney was the only man for the part." And so the work began. But production had its share of strains. Cohan insisted that his approved script be followed to the letter. Cagney didn't see it that way at all and insisted on a rewrite. $1.5 million later, after a lot of tension and hard work, Cohan entered the Burbank projection room to see the finished product. Warner was in a state of nervous exhaustion. He'd learned that Cagney, every bit as stubborn and determined as Cohan, had surreptitiously reworked the scenario on a day-to-day basis. Cohan watched the picture with the mildest enthusiasm and left the theatrette without making comment. Warners held their breath. Remember, George had approval rights and could veto any scene or the whole project if it came to that. But after thinking about it for a few days, he gave the studio the thumbs up. In May of 1942, Yankee Doodle Dandy had a gala Broadway opening. First night tickets were sold for war bonds. The best 88 seats sold for $25,000 each. No seat that night cost less than $25. In a year when a dollar was worth every bit of 100 cents, Yankee Doodle Dandy, on its first night, made for the U.S. Treasury Department the astonishing amount for its time of $5.75 million.
I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy, Yankee Doodle do or die. A real live nephew of my Uncle Sam, born on the 4th of July. I've got a Yankee Doodle sweetheart, she's my Yankee Doodle joy. Yankee Doodle came to London just to ride the ponies. I am that Yankee Doodle boy.
Oh, things were tough. But at least I was in New York. I had a trunk full of songs and play scripts and a heart full of confidence. I'm glad I had it.
I'm sorry, I can't use this, Cohan.
Youth needs confidence. I'd learned my job the hard way, all over the United States. And now guys who had never been past the corner cigar store were saying my stuff was no good. A kid had to believe in himself to buck that.
Yankee Doodle Dandy was an acclaimed success. The New York Journal American, Mr. Cagney's most brilliant piece of make-believe. The New York Times, as bold and respectable a performance as anyone could wish. Time Magazine, it is a remarkable performance, possibly Cagney's best. And so it was judged at that year's Academy Awards, when Cagney collected the Oscar as Best Actor. George M. Cohan was a complicated man, a man of many contradictions. Vain, at times childish and temperamental, but also generous, sentimental, and affectionate. He worked hard and with an attention and absorption matched by few. Cohan was the right man for the times, in a newly emerging 20th century America, bursting with the acceleration of speed and movement, in a country vibrant and expanding. The motor car, the subway, the spreading arteries of the railroad. Cohan captured the mood and translated it into the musical. Brassy? Yes. Brash? Certainly. But with that dash of brilliance that set him apart from his contemporaries and sent the American musical in a new and exciting direction. In 1959, the new generation of Broadway workers and the city of New York erected a permanent monument to George M. Cohan right in the heart of Theaterland, where Broadway snakes its way across Times Square in Midtown Manhattan. There stands George, immobile, silent, in the part of the land that meant so much to him.
Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square.
He was a very great American songwriter who wrote many patriotic American songs.
Did you like him?
Yes, very much.
Did you think he was important to Broadway?
Certainly he was important to Broadway. Well, I'm not very good at remembering the names of songs, but he had songs that were very popular in World War I, the Doughboys overseas.
Tell all the gang at 42nd Street that I will soon be there.
Not everybody would know it, but I'm a native New Yorker, so I know him. George M. Cohan, sure, he was a famous composer, a musician. And a lot of the musicals are based upon his productions, George M. Cohan. I say he's one of the fathers of American music.
Whisper of how I'm yearning to mingle with the old-time crowd.
He's a great Broadway composer and actor and dancer. He was synonymous with 42nd Street in the 20s, teens in the 20s. Yeah, so I imagine anybody who has any interest in entertainment knows who George M. Cohan was.
Yes, give my regards to old Broadway and say that I'll be there ere long.
He was an actor, songwriter, and he wrote quite a few songs like Give My Regards to Broadway, Yankee Doodle Dancer. He was a dancer.
You think he was important?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
On Broadway, one of the most important men at the time. And he had a family he worked with. And in his day, he was as important, we'll say, as Muhammad Ali today.
Each day, as tourists and theatre-goers give their regards to George on Broadway, his music continues to radiate around the world, as Voice of America beamed the Yankee Doodle message on 100 frequencies. The music of George M. Cohan, even today, epitomizes the sound of America to millions around the globe.
This is the Voice of America, broadcasting from Washington.
George M. Cohan, sure.
Evidently, he has something to do with the theater.
Didn't they do a movie about him? Yeah, they did a movie about him. Didn't he do, like, a rhapsody and something?
For he loves and can't give you the ball.
Life and Times of George M. Cohan, prepared and presented by Geoff Howard.